Good afternoon, everyone. Please do not hold it against me that I am a trial lawyer. I am very pleased to be here. Dave, thank you for that introduction. I want to have really a conversation with this very large and distinguished group of security specialists about the current threat environment. I have no prepared remarks. I will not read. Instead, I want to have a conversation with you. My principal message here this afternoon is that our partnership between the public and private sectors devoted to security, the Department of Homeland Security, the FBI, the Department of Defense, our intelligence community, our national security apparatus of our government, state and local law enforcement on the one hand, and you people, dedicated also to public safety and the protection of our homeland in the private sector, has never been more important given our current threat environment. We must, now more than ever, function as an effective partnership for the good of the people we all serve. Yesterday was the 15th anniversary of 9/11. I was at the World Trade Center. I had been at the commemoration at the World Trade Center before. I'm a New Yorker. I was present in Manhattan on September 11th, 2001, as a private citizen. Last year, I went to Shanksville, Pennsylvania. I had never been to Shanksville before. It is a remote countryside, out of the way place in rural Pennsylvania. I have been to the commemorations each 9/11 at the Pentagon, New York City, Shanksville. And I have two thoughts that I want to share with you about these commemorations. One, Shanksville is perhaps most emblematic of the terrorist threat we face today. The monument there is striking because it's an elegant, sleek, modern monument in the middle of vast countryside, in the middle of farmland. And it brings home how random terrorism can be. No one prior to September 11th, 2001 could have ever imagined that Shanksville, Pennsylvania would be one of the sites of the worst terrorist attack in our nation's history. The other thought I have for you is that on events like 9/11, it's important to look back, to commemorate those who were lost, the heroes on that day, on the land and in the air, but to also continue to rebuild, to look forward. We are a resilient, strong nation. We always come back stronger than we were before. It's no accident that the year after the Boston Marathon bombing in 2013, thousands of additional runners signed up to run that same marathon in 2014. One World Trade Center is taller than the Twin Towers that existed on 9/11. 2 days before 9/11, this past Friday, I was pleased to preside at a ceremony which was intended to be an uplifting ceremony at One World Trade Center to mark the U.S. government's return to that building. We had a ribbon cutting of sorts, and it is emblematic of the strength of this country. We rebuild, we come back stronger. So I do want to talk to you today about the current threat environment and what we face. Let me begin by reporting to you some things about what is happening with your Department of Homeland Security. And I use the word your very purposefully. We are public servants. We serve the people. We serve the people you serve. We're building a more efficient and effective Department of Homeland Security to deliver our Homeland Security services like you do to the American people. We're building a more effective and efficient partner with you. Through the Unity of Effort initiative that I announced over 2 years ago, we're doing a number of things to centralize decision-making, acquisition, restructuring our headquarters functions, revising, revamping, streamlining our decision-making when it comes to hiring, budget-making, acquisition. After soliciting the views of our entire 226,000-person workforce, we've developed a mission statement intended to unify our vast workforce across 22 different components. We received over 3,000 submissions for ideas. The principal words that came forth from our employees were honor, integrity, safeguard, and values. Our mission statement therefore reads, with honor and integrity, we will safeguard the American people, our homeland, and our values. It's a statement that everyone across the Department of Homeland Security, whether you're a TSO or a member of the United States Coast Guard or a Border Patrol agent or a cybersecurity expert, should recognize and appreciate. We're lifting morale across our 226,000 person workforce. We've seen rising levels, increased levels of employee participation in employee satisfaction surveys. The results this year will be out in a week, and I look forward to receiving those results. I am confident that employee morale, employee satisfaction across our department is rising. We've also spruced up our image a bit as your partner. Let me show you a short little promotional movie. I appreciated the one I just saw for ASIS. Now check out what we have to show you in the Department of Homeland Security.
Record-setting year with TSA officers confiscating more than 2,600 firearms nationwide.
I want to say how grateful I am to all of the law enforcement who worked together, who brought their A-game.
In a single year, the Coast Guard and Border Protection intercepted an astonishing $10 billion worth of drugs on the way to America.
This is the most sophisticated tunnel that has ever been discovered along the border.
I call the allegiance to the flag of the United States of America.
ICE enforcement and removal operations arrested 331 criminal aliens and immigration violators.
HSI arrested more than 1,200 from gangs across the U.S.
1,000 child victims were identified and rescued, with Homeland Security Investigations agents arresting nearly 3,000 child predators.
2 weeks since historic flooding left thousands of Houstonians underwater, FEMA has opened 4 disaster recovery centers in the hardest hit areas.
the U.S. Coast Guard came through with flying colors, rescuing 33,000 people.
To disrupt terrorist attacks, to make our borders more secure, respond to natural disasters, and make our immigration system more effective and fair. Now, addressing any one of these challenges is a tall order. Addressing all of them at once is a monumental task. But that's what the dedicated men and women of the Department of Homeland Security do every day.
Right. You know, it occurred to me that some of you may have seen some of your products in this movie. If so, congratulations. Yesterday at the World Trade Center, I did 8 television interviews, 4 local, 4 national, all before 8:30 in the morning. And I was asked basically the same question over and over again. Are we safer? And I'll tell you what I said. Yes, when it comes to another 9/11 style attack, our government over the last 15 years has built a pretty good capability to detect and prevent plots by groups, large-scale attacks from overseas, launched from overseas, exported to our country. We do a better job of connecting the dots. Our intelligence community is far more sophisticated. Our counterterrorism capability is far more sophisticated. But we're in a new phase. We are now in a phase where we have to be concerned not only about the terrorist-directed style attack, the most prominent example being 9/11, to now the terrorist-inspired attack. If the most prominent example of a terrorist-directed attack is 9/11, or the attempted underwear bomber, December 25, 2009, or the attempted shoe bomber, or the attempted Times Square car bomb, all in the category of terrorist-directed attacks, in this new phase, we now, all of us, have to be concerned about the prospect of a terrorist-inspired attack. The Boston Marathon bombing, San Bernardino, Orlando, here. This morning before I came here, I went to the Pulse nightclub. And it is a reminder of our new threat environment. Yesterday was the 15-year anniversary of 9/11. Today is the 3-month anniversary of the Pulse nightclub attack. In this new phase of self-radicalization, the lone wolf, the terrorist-inspired attack, this type of attack is frankly harder to detect by our law enforcement community and our intelligence community in advance. This type of attack could occur many different places. Orlando, San Bernardino, Chattanooga, the attempted effort in Garland City, Texas. All of us have to be prepared for this new threat environment. It is a threat environment in which soft targets are at risk. Public places and public events. Last December, we revised our national terrorism advisory system to put out to the public what we see and what we are concerned about. So in government, here's what we are doing. First, militarily, we continue to take the fight to ISIL and Al-Qaeda overseas. Our military, along with our coalition partners, taking back territory in Iraq and Syria. We're degrading their leadership, their ability to communicate, their ability to finance, but much more needs to be done overseas. Here at home, our FBI is an aggressive counterterrorism actor. Their counterterrorism capability is impressive. To detect, investigate, interdict, prevent, and prosecute terrorist plots here in our homeland. We're working much more closely, given this current environment, with state and local law enforcement. Here again, another partnership. The Department of Homeland Security and FBI working side by side with state and local law enforcement through joint task forces, fusion centers, joint intelligence bulletins, active shooter training. I've said many times that it's the cop on the beat that could detect the next terrorist attack on the United States. We're hardening security at federal buildings through our FPS and by other means. We've doubled down on aviation and airport security. 2 years ago, I directed enhanced aviation security overseas at last point of departure airports. We enhanced aviation security last summer in response to the test results by the Inspector General, which many of you, I'm sure, have read about. We're doing more in the Middle East, in that region, to bolster airport security at last point of departure airports. We're rebuilding our TSO workforce. TSA this year will seize most likely a record number of handguns in carry-on luggage through their hard work and technology. We're investing in TSA's future. We're investing in new technology. We're building a pre-clearance capability at airports overseas, at last point of departure airports overseas, where our customs personnel are forward deployed overseas. We now have this capability at 15 overseas airports, 16% of which of all traveling public to this country passes through. We're building more of this. I want to see more pre-clearance capability overseas to better screen people who come into our homeland. Last year, in FY15, through pre-clearance, we denied boarding to 10,717 travelers attempting to come to our homeland. We've added security around our visa waiver program, the program by which countries participate and their nationals come here without a visa. We've added security to that program, the result of which a number of people who attempt to come here visa-free are denied boarding. Through our National Targeting Center at CBP, we have an increasing level of sophistication when it comes to tracking the travel of suspicious of individuals. We're building a social media capability. We're building a social media center for excellence to develop best practices for monitoring the social media of immigrants in various different contexts and for various different law enforcement investigative means. We're working with our allies overseas with their border security, their security around travel through HSPD-6s. We're working with the government of Turkey and a number of others. Here at home, we're building bridges to various communities, including specifically American Muslim communities, the very communities that the Islamic State and Al-Qaeda are trying to target for recruitment. In my judgment, it is essential that we build relationships, build bridges with these communities to say to them, help us help you with our homeland security efforts. Last weekend, I was the first cabinet officer to address a full convention of the Islamic Society of North America. I hope others in the future in national security will do the same. It's essential that we build bridges to American Muslim communities in the current threat environment. There's a role for the general public to play as well. Public vigilance, public awareness can and has made a difference. It is almost always the case when someone self-radicalizes that there's someone else who saw the warning signs. We must encourage people in that situation to come forward. If you see something, say something is more than a slogan, and we're entering into partnerships with the NFL, Major League Baseball, and the like to enhance this messaging capability. Most important for this audience, our partners in our homeland security efforts, in this threat environment, as I said earlier, our partnership is more important than ever. You security professionals have a critical role in our public safety, in our homeland security. We've developed this new program in DHS, Hometown Security, which I hope all of you have had an opportunity to take a look at. There are four components of this plan: connect, plan, train, and report. All of us have a role in protecting soft targets, infrastructure, critical infrastructure. I pledge to you the resources we have in our department to support your efforts to engage in information sharing, the best practices, programs like this one here. Now more than ever, it's critical. People like to ask me, what keeps you up at night? The single thing that keeps me up at night is the prospect of the next lone wolf attack, the next self-radicalized actor or small group of actors that could strike almost anywhere. So, a few weeks ago, when I was talking to my Assistant Secretary for Infrastructure Protection, Caitlin Durkovich, how do we get this word out, the importance of your role? Her answer was immediate and simple. Come speak at this convention. So here I am. Ladies and gentlemen, very often in Washington, you hear a lot of canned statements. This is not a canned statement. We need you now more than ever for public safety, for the protection of your families, your businesses, the clients you serve, private and public. We need you now more than ever. I'll leave you with an encouraging word. Sometimes people forget this. Our nation is as resilient and as strong as any nation on earth. We do come back stronger after tragedy, whether it's a natural disaster or man-made. We are a resilient nation. 9/11/2001 was, for me, as I'm sure it was for many of you, my saddest, darkest day as an American. But we come back. 3 days ago, we dedicated a stronger, taller World Trade Center. Perhaps my best day in public service after 9/11 was May 1, 2011, the day we killed Osama bin Laden, thanks to the bravery of our special forces. We always come back stronger. When I was just at Pulse nightclub, I laid some flowers, a wreath there, and there was a woman who was a chaplain who was standing there, who'd done a lot to support the community after this tragedy 3 months ago. It's the first time she'd ever visited. And it was a reminder to me that out of tragedy, whether it's a 9/11, the Pulse nightclub, or Baton Rouge, Louisiana, where I visited about a month ago after the floods there, you always see the best in people. You always see the best in Americans respond to a tragedy, come together, volunteer, pull together, help your neighbor. You always see the best of America. I look out at you, and I hope I see the best of America here too. I believe I do, in terms of the dedication that you have to our collective mission. So I leave you with the thought that our Homeland Security mission is not over, It's as vital as it ever has been. I want you to keep up the good work, and thank you for everything that you do. Thanks a lot.